So Apple has just announced a host of new features for their Apple Watch platform called WatchOS 11. That's a new one that's just coming out. And they announced it here at WWDC at Apple's headquarters. This is the Apple building, the infamous spaceship behind me there. But two notable things first. I'm standing in the bike share parking lot of sorts because there's a lot of new fitness focused features here. And also the second notable really interesting thing is that all of the walking and pedestrian paths here have the icon for the workout app. Basically the exact same running walking icon that you would see on your watch is on all of the walking paths here. It's just like a really cool little thing that I think is a nice touch. In any case, I'm gonna dive into all of the new features on WatchOS 11, including things like sport fitness features and non-sport fitness features and everything in between. But first, like 30 quick seconds on what WWDC is. This is Apple's annual developer conference, their worldwide developer conference, and it's when basically Apple will take off the covers of all the software initiatives they have going on for pretty much the upcoming year. Not just on the watch side, but on your phone and on iPad and macOS and you name it, it's all gonna be covered there. Then what happens is over the next few months, developers can take advantage of those new features leading up to September when they typically announce new hardware, like new watches and new phones and things like that. But this essentially gives us a preview of about like 80-90% of the new features that are coming on the new watches here in a few months. But don't worry, it's not just the new watches. All the watches back to Apple Watch Series 6 are getting all of these updates as well. So if you've got an older watch or just like a current watch, you're in good luck there as well. Okay, so the big first feature here is training load. But with that, we have to first talk about the effort score because the effort score is the underpinnings for training load. So the way this works is that the effort score happens after every single one of your workouts. For 17 different workout types, it'll happen automatically, and for the rest, you can manually assign it. So it's gonna look at that workout, it's gonna look at your pace, your heart rate, your age, your height, your weight, elevation of that workout, and it's gonna figure out how hard that workout was. Essentially, a really, really hard workout, like an all-out balls-to-the-wall workout, is gonna get a score of 10, an easier workout's gonna get a score of 1. You'll see that workout score at the end of the workout in the summary, like all your other kind of summary metrics, but you can adjust that by simply tapping on it and increasing or decreasing it. So if you think it was harder or easier than it was, you can adjust that there. As I mentioned, that'll happen on 17 different workout types automatically, but you can always assign an effort score if you want to, and you can actually tell it to ask you every single time after a workout, no matter what particular workout type you're doing. Now from there, they're gonna take those effort scores, combine it with your duration, and start to plot training load. Generally speaking, training load looks at your intensity over time. You can see in the image there, there's two different lines. There's a white line and then a squiggly line. The white line is your 28-day average, and the squiggly line is the 7-day average. You'll then see your difference to the baseline, for example, 20% higher, lower, etc. And that's assigned a classifier of well below, below, steady, above, or well above, again, your 7-day baseline against your 28-day baseline. And this is very similar to what most other companies do as well. However, the big difference here is that you're not seeing any numbers. You're not seeing a training load number like you would on a Garmin watch or a Polar watch or something like that. Instead, you're all seeing relative values. And the reason for that is kind of twofold. Number one, Apple's going for more of a mainstream, broader approach here. By throwing a bunch of numbers at it, it makes it more complicated, especially if it decodes what those numbers mean, versus this is fairly easy to decode and fairly easy to figure out. But interestingly, the second reason actually makes it better for certain types of activities. For example, I tend to do a lot of really long treks or hikes or things like that. And when I do those treks or hikes, I don't get really accurate training load numbers for most other sport and fitness watches. That's because training load on most other sport and fitness watches is heavily based on your heart rate and high heart rate zones. So when you do something like a hike on the whole, you tend to have a lower heart rate than doing like a hard 5K run or something like that. Yet if I were to go out and do a 10 or 14 hour hike, my legs, my muscles would be absolutely shot. So from a holistic training load standpoint, I am totally shot. And this is where Apple's system does account for that because I can then adjust that effort score value that I see to be a higher value, which in turn impacts training load. Something I can't do on virtually every other watch or wearable out there today. Now, as you expect, you can see all these scores on the watch, but also see them in the companion app as well, the fitness app, and you can trend those over time. And one of the things you can trend against those things over time, be it 1 month, 3 months, 6 month, etc., is the vitals. And vitals are a new app, or is a new app, that allows you to track 5 core things. The first one is resting heart rate, breathing rate, skin temperature, blood oxygen, and sleep. So essentially the same things you'd find like in a Fitbit or anything like that. That's now finally being trended and shown in one like easy spot, both on your watch, but as well on the app itself. That might sound like a minor thing, and it kind of is in a way, but it's actually a bigger step towards probably the broader approach to what Apple's gonna be doing here, and that you have to have those core metrics easily accessible versus being like stuffed deep down in the health app like they've been in the past. Now within these vitals, again, it's gonna trend them against your baseline, and you're gonna see any vitals that stick out from the norm. So if you had a bad night's sleep, you might see one of those listed as an outlier showing a bad night's sleep. And again, those are norms against your baseline, so they're gonna adjust based on what is normal for you. However, if you have two outliers, then you'll get a push notification to your phone telling you can look at the app to see more details about what might be causing that outlier. Now, it's not gonna provide you with details about what exactly is causing that outlier. It's just gonna give you a whole list of like spaghetti at the wall and be like, could be one of these things. Could be too much drinking or jet lag or sickness or whatever the case is. That's for you to kind of sort out. And there isn't any sort of tie-in to journal apps or something like that to be able to pull that insights out from those. So at this point, you have basically two silos of information. You have your training load that's based on workout data, and then you have your vitals based on your 24/7 data. In both of those apps, you can see the other side of it. So you can see your vitals within the training load side of it, and then on the vital side, you can see one line for your training load pieces. But those two aren't intertwined together like you would see on a Whoop band or any other device out there. Apple isn't doing any sort of correlation between those. I think that's an obvious next step, but first they had to establish those pillars, and then hopefully, down the road, they'll start to kind of establish a correlation between those two things, like poor sleep and whether or not you recovery or stuff like that. Which, as a note, there is no recovery time either, like you'd see in some wearables. It's purely showing training load in vitals, and there's also no taking into account of HRV at this point in time. Now, of course, there's a ton of stuff to explore here in real life and see if all this like lives up to what Apple's saying. So definitely hit the subscribe button, because I will do that like I always do in deep dives and figure out how things actually work. So with that, let's get to the next big ticket item, which is a whole bunch of changes around mapping, offline mapping, and route creation. The first one is you can now create custom routes. Up until now, when you created a route that pushed from maps on your phone to the Apple Watch, it was basically point to point, because that's kind of how like driving directions worked on Apple Maps, and eventually they added pedestrian and biking and stuff like that. But it was always like going from point A to point B. It was never to create a round trip route like you'd normally do for a hike or something like that. Now you can do that with your phone, or with the iPad, or with a Mac, and then from there it'll sync into your watch. And what's cool is that it'll automatically sync the offline maps into your watch for the route that you've created. So if you've gone out and created a route in, I don't know, Colorado somewhere, it'll sync the offline maps for Colorado. And then that gets to a huge, huge point. Apple now finally has true offline maps on your watch. In the past, a year ago when they announced offline maps, it was offline on your phone, and as long as your watch and phone with each other, they could talk to each other. But now it's actually offline on your watch with no phone dependency at all. And that's applicable for anywhere in the world. However, if you are in the US, in the next like 20 seconds is applicable to you as well, and that there is now suggested routes for US national parks. This means in US national parks, so they have a published route or a published hike, those suggested hikes will show up in the Apple Maps app, and you can push them to your watch using the same kind of routing as before. And a couple final tidbits on the routing and mapping side. When you create a new custom route, you can basically go outbound. Say you went out like 5 miles on some trail, and you just want to tell it to go straight back the exact same route. You can do that in one tap to come straight back to the beginning. Or you can go ahead and tell it to create an alternate loop of some sort that goes on a different route coming back to get you back to the beginning, and just chooses the route that it thinks is the best for that particular activity type. Keeping in mind, the activity types here are pedestrian activities only. So running, hiking, walking, but not cycling. Also, there's no third-party routing provider support like you'd see on structured training. So something like Strava routes or Commute can't push into this, unfortunately, at least at this point in time. Now, we've got 8 more things on the fitness side that are new. That'll be more like quick, fast hit stuff. And then we got a whole bunch of non-fitness things. Number one, you can now pause your activity rings and keep your streaks. So the idea being, if you're sick or traveling or injured or whatever the case is, you can pause it. You can choose to pause it for the day, for the week, for the month, or any time period up to 90 days. You can also now change and customize your move goals. So you can say, hey, I do long rides on the weekend or long runs on the weekend, therefore I want to increase my move goals there. But on Mondays for work, I'm just slammed, so I want to decrease that, and that'll apply to future weeks as well. You can now also customize your fitness app dashboard, so you can move all the different panels around as you see fit. There's new panels for training load, of course, in there, as well as a bunch of new widgets for running mileage and stuff like that. And those new widgets for the mileage will also show up as complications on your watch. Next, on swimming, they're finally supporting structured swimming workouts. So up until now, you could create a custom workout for running or cycling, but you couldn't do it for swimming. Now you can. And that includes a new feature to be able to set a target based on a time-based interval. So for example, doing 100 meters on every 140. So swimmers will know what that means. You can now do that in the app. And then with that, Apple's also added the ability for third parties to customize the names of those workout segments. So you see in this picture right here where it says freestyle, that is actually a handwritten note for freestyle. It's opposed to saying work. In the past, that would have said work. Now it says freestyle. And you can customize that to be whatever you want. And then lastly, on the fitness side of things, there's a new check-in feature. So you've had check Checkin on your phone for I think a year or so now, where basically you can tell it to check in with a friend before you leave somewhere. And then if you don't check in, it'll kind of tell the friend to nudge you and see what's up. And they're basically, it's a live tracking of where you are. That now carries over to the watch, and in particular within the workout app. So when you start a workout, you can start a check-in from the watch as well, and it does the exact same thing. And so if the watch notices that you're staying still for a long time, it may just prompt you and say, hey, is everything all right? And if you don't respond, it'll prompt your friend and say, hey, go check on your friend, there's something up there. Okay, next up, we got a whole list of non-fitness items for WatchOS, WatchOS updates that are pretty interesting. Number one is the Photos app now. If you use the Photos app to go ahead and have your watch faces updated, it'll automatically pick photos that it thinks are like the most photogenic, and then basically stylize those to have overlays that look right on those particular watch faces, like to ensure that the watch hands and stuff like that aren't on the people's faces and all that kind of stuff. It sounds pretty cool. I'm looking forward to poking at that a little bit more. They've also added a new intelligent smart stack. So smart stack is where you can see what are effectively the widgets there, but now it's a little more smart. So it'll look at things like if it's gonna rain out, it'll show you the precipitation that's upcoming and stuff like that. So it's now more contextually aware about what's going on. In fact, a good example of one of those new widgets is the translation widget. This will now automatically show up when you land in a country that has a language other than your device language. So say my phone is set for English and I land in France, I'll see it basically show and start to translate for French. There are 20 languages that'll pull totally offline, so you don't have to be connected to the internet for this to work, and you can translate using voice back and forth using that widget, which is a pretty cool little touch. Now, the last item I want to mention is super cool and probably shouldn't have saved it to last, but it's the way it works, and is not actually on the watch side, but on the phone side. If you have a newer iPhone that has the emergency SOS feature, where you can basically point it at the sky if you're out in a place that has no cellular coverage or no Wi-Fi to get emergency assistance, now you can do normal text messaging, both iMessage as well as SMS messages, via satellite coverage. Now keep in mind, you do have to point this at a certain location in the sky. So you're not gonna be able to sit like in a remote log cabin inside by the fire and do text messaging. But if you're doing a multi-day hike like I often do and often outside of cellular coverage, this is awesome. It really bridges the gap for a lot of people, giving them kind of that day-to-day just check in, say, hey, I reached my camp, I reached my next location, all is good, versus having to have the emergency side, which of course is a huge escalation of things that isn't really necessary in most cases for just simply checking in from a hike. Anyways, this is a huge slate of things in some really interesting areas. As always, the devil is in the detail and all this stuff and diving into it and seeing how well it works. I'm gonna get my watches updated here in just a couple hours and starting to figure out how all the different components work, the training load, the mapping, and all these pieces. And I will report back here in a little while into all those features. And again, as always, figuring out how they work and how they compare to their competitors. Once again, if you found this video interesting and useful, go ahead and whack the like or subscribe button. It really does help with this video and the channel quite a bit. Have a good one.